You may have heard of the word recursion when discussing topics in computer science or math, such as recursive sequences or recursive functions. But what actually is recursion, and what uses does it have?
Well, according to Wikipedia, recursion occurs when the definition of a concept or process depends on a simpler version of itself. Now, if you don't fully understand this definition, that is totally okay. Let's look at applying this step by step to a problem to hopefully build an intuition.
Suppose we have a staircase of length n, and we can travel one or two steps at a time. This leads to the natural question, how many distinct ways can we travel to reach the top? Let's do some visualization. Right here is what one possible staircase could look like. It should be pretty clear that it would be extremely time consuming to manually count all the ways given a staircase this large. So, let's try to see if there's some hidden patterns. Let's do a simpler case with a staircase of length 1. So, as the problem stated, we can either take one step or two steps. However, because this staircase is just a single stair, we can only get to the top by taking one step. So, there is one distinct way to travel to the top. Now, imagine we have a staircase of length 2. Then we can either take one single step and another single step to get to the top, or we can take two steps to reach the top. Therefore, we know there's a total of two distinct ways to travel to the top of a staircase of length 2. Now, again, let's increase the length of the staircase. We will first take a single step, and we can see that there is two final steps to travel. We can travel these two final steps either by taking only single steps, or we can take a single double step. Lastly, we can start by taking a double step and then a single step. Therefore, we see that there is a total of three distinct ways to travel to the top. Do you see a pattern here? One possible pattern is that a staircase of length n has n distinct ways to get to the top. Let's add another step and see if this still is true. So first, we can travel one step, and now there's three steps left to reach the top. As we have previously shown, we could travel these in three distinct ways. Suppose that instead we first took a double step. So there is two final steps to reach the top. Again, we have shown that we can travel these two steps in two distinct ways. Summing both these together, we see that there is five distinct ways to travel to the top. Unfortunately, the pattern does not hold. However, hopefully another pattern starts to become clear. There will be one final staircase, this time of length 5. Immediately, let's travel one step. Now we can see that there is four steps left. As was shown in the previous problem, this can be done in five ways. Now, first take two steps, then there is a total of three steps left. Again, we have shown that this can be traveled in three ways. So, there is a total of eight ways to travel to the top of a staircase of length 5. The pattern is, the number of ways to travel to the top of a staircase of length n is the sum of the number of ways to travel to the top of a staircase of length n minus 1 and length n minus 2. The base case being the number of ways to travel one step or two steps. If we were to define this as a sequence, it would look like this. Now, this is pretty great. We can immediately know the number of ways to travel by looking at the nth element of this recursive sequence. However, in the real world, we have to compute this sequence. Hopefully, one can see that computing the sequence for any sufficiently large n does not take an insignificant amount of time. Additionally, if we are only interested in knowing the number of ways to travel a staircase of length n, we would have to compute the number of ways to travel n minus 1 and n minus 2. And again, we are only interested in knowing n itself, so this would just be a waste of computation. This leads us to the natural question, is there a better way of doing this? By better, I mean a way that doesn't require us to know the number of stairs leading up to n, and instead, just n itself. Well, there is. What we are after is called the closed form solution. There's a couple of different ways to go about finding this. The most interesting is through the use of generating functions. However, first what we will do is rename the sequence as an and shift it back one. Next, we define the generating function g of x to be equal to the power series, where the nth coefficient is given by the nth element of the sequence an. Now, what we are after is having both sides be power series with the same degree of x. We can do this through the following steps. First, we multiply both sides of the equation by x squared. Then, we sum over both sides. Now, let's grab the first term on the left side. Hopefully, one notices that this looks pretty familiar to the power series that we just defined, only this has n plus 2 instead of just n. If we go back to the power series and write it out term by term, we would end up with this. Now, let's go back to the power series on the left side and write it out term by term as well. Notice that these look very similar. However, the power series on the left side starts with the element that is the third element of the generating function. So, if we subtract the first two elements of the generating function, we end up with the power series. Now we can sub in the values for a0 and a1 and rewrite the left side in terms of the generating function. Now, the rest should look pretty similar. Let's grab the first term on the right side of the equation and factor out an x. So now we have a summation that starts at n plus 1. So the first term is a1 and x. So what we can do is just write it as the generating function minus a0 x to the 0. Again, we can sub in for a0 the value that we found. Now we know it in terms of the generating function, but we still have to deal with the x. We can just leave it in its factored form for now and replace it in the equation. Lastly, we have the last term on the right side of the equation. What we can do is factor out x squared from the summation, and we can see that this summation is simply the generating function. Again, we can rewrite this in the equation in terms of the generating function. Now we can put it in the unfactored form and solve the generating function in terms of x. After doing that, we will use partial fraction decomposition to further simplify it. Don't worry, the reason for this will become clear later. So, what we will do is factor the denominator of the first term on the right side of the equation. This can be done with the quadratic equation. After we factor it, we will set it equal to two unknown variables a and b over each of the factors. What we are after is the values of a and b that make this equation true. What we can do is multiply both sides by the denominator of the left side. Now, we have it simplified a bit, but it is still not clear what values of a and b will make this equality true. We can accomplish this by a few different methods. The easiest in this case is to choose values of x that will make one of the variables a or b disappear. This value is pretty easy to see because the equation is already factored. After some simplifying, we know what b is equal to. We can rewrite b in the equation, and then we just have to solve for a. Again, the simplest method here will just be to put in a value for x that will cancel the right side. After some simplifying, we know what a is equal to, and then we can substitute back into the equation. Now, let's deal with the term on the right side of the equation. We will use partial fraction decomposition again. The denominator is the same as the previous one, so it has the same factors. We will set it equal to two unknown variables a and b and solve for the values that make the equality true. This time it is a bit more complicated because x is in the numerator of the left side, however it will be similar to the last one. Again, what we will do is choose values for x that will cancel one of the unknown variables. After some further simplifying, we know what b is equal to, and then we just have to solve for a. This can be done by using the same method as before. After a little bit more simplifying, we know what a is equal to, and now we are ready to sub it back into the equation. Now we will just simplify this a bit by using some basic algebra. Now, what we want to do is use the fact that this is awfully close to being in the form of a geometric series, which would allow us to rewrite it. Rewriting in this form would allow us to have both sides of the equation be a power series. Now, we can put it in this form by factoring out of the bottom a value that will make it in the form 1 minus some other number. We can further simplify it and then finally rewrite it as a geometric series. Now, because both sides are in the form of a power series, and because both sides have the same power of x, this tells us that they will be equal if and only if the coefficients are the same. And because they are equal, we are able to conclude that the coefficients are the same. But what we can see is that on the left side, we have an element of the recursive sequence, but on the right side, we have it in terms of two exponentials. But we have to rewrite it because we shifted the sequence. We know bn is equal to an minus 1, so we can sub in the new value for n, and then simplify it a bit further. After a little bit more simplifying, we are left with the closed form solution. I think what I find most interesting about this is not only did we accomplish our goal of making it better, but the way we went about it. The idea that to solve a problem, we rewrite it as an infinite series and then go through some interesting algebra, such as the geometric substitution, partial fraction decomposition, and shifting the series, has a great beauty to it, I believe. Lastly, thanks if you watched the whole video. I would greatly appreciate it if you subscribed and liked it and shared. Thanks again.